Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today. Today we have Francesco Prinzi, which is a PhD student of the University of Palermo, working under the supervision of Professor Salvatore Vitabile, talking about explainable machine learning models for COVID-19 prognosis prediction. Francesco, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Alex, for this opportunity. Really, thank you. I will discuss basically our solution proposed to an hackathon. It's a competition, international competition, about COVID-19 prognosis. Basically, the competition was focused on the development of machine learning solution with a particular focus on explainable solution. So I will present our solution that was our between the three best solution as accuracy solution. Okay, we participated with the Medical Imaging Lab group that basically is composed by Professor Vitabile, that is the head of laboratory. Me and Tiziana that are a PhD student, and Carmelo Militello that is a researcher of National Research Council of Italy. In general, as a really little bit overview of Medical Imaging Lab, basically we are focused on the medical imaging processing and analysis. Development of machine learning and deep learning solution with a particular focus on explainable artificial intelligence, clinical decision support system, and so on. So with the QR code, you can visit our website and explore more details about our laboratory. So we can start discussing about the needed. Why we need to talk about explainable artificial intelligence. Basically, this is the conventional pipeline in which we pre-process the data, training, test, validation, and in the end, we can use the trained models for the inference process. At the end of this workflow, we can obtain just a probability about the prediction. In this case, the prediction was the binary classification between mild and severe prognosis. So in the clinical context and in many other contexts, it is mandatory to explain the prediction. So why we talk about mild prediction. Why mild and why not severe prediction? So in general, this is a black box pipeline because the models, the trained models like neural network, support vector machine, and the main algorithms are black box basically. So just return some probability about the prediction. To improve this concept in our solution proposed for the COVID, we want to give an explanation about the prediction, but why we need to explain the prediction. In particular, in the medical field, we need to analyze the three different aspects, that is the ethical, legal, and the acceptance trust, acceptance aspect. The ethical aspect because it's really common that some artificial intelligence-based algorithms present some bias inside the trained model. And there are a lot of examples in which the system are biased related to the minority group, for example. So we need to discuss about ethical for fairness, safety, and privacy. We need to discuss about the legal aspect because after the introduction of the GDPR, there are the 15 and the 22 articles that discuss the need about the explanation. In particular, for the article 15, when the processed data are sensitive data, of course, the patient data are sensitive data. is needed an explanation about the system. And the article 22, in which when the system are used to make decision for the patient, is a right for the patient, an explanation about the decision. And then for the acceptance, because physician patient are of course not expert about artificial intelligence, and to trust the system is mandatory to explain how this model works. So in general, we can use explainable artificial intelligence to analyze these three aspects, because the focus of the artificial explainable XAI, explainable artificial intelligence is XAI, interpret and understand the internal logic and outcome of algorithms in summary. So focusing on our solution proposed for COVID-19 prognosis, we started thinking about these two requirements. So we want high performance, of course. So we don't want to give up the performance. And we can use the black box algorithms like neural network, support vector machine, tree-ensemble, and so on. But we want to interpretable and explainable solutions. So we want to explain the solution, the black box algorithms. So in this case, we have two main way to implement to satisfy these two requirements. The first one is to choose intrinsically interpretable data input and algorithms, in particular using clinical radiomics. We will discuss about radiomics. Clinical radiomics and genomics data are intrinsically interpretable input just because are human understandable. And algorithms like rule-based decision tree linear regression are intrinsically interpretable, so it's possible to explain the prediction of this algorithm without some other steps or some other algorithms. The second scenario is to use every data input, basically, so clinical radiomics, deep features, so extracted with convolutional neural network, for example, that is a black box algorithms, using any algorithms like tree-ensemble, neural network, and support machine, that are another time black box. But in this scenario, we need to introduce an post hoc explanation. So we need to use explainable algorithms to explain the prediction, so to explain the black box algorithms used. In particular, to provide a global and local explanation. In our solution, we decided to use of course, intrinsically interpretable features, so only clinical and radiomics. We avoid the deep features because it's harder to explain the deep features. We will discuss in the end about this aspect. And we use a black box algorithm, in particular tree-ensemble and support vector machine. And in the end, we provide a post hoc explanation for the global and local explanation. So who need the explainability? Basically, we identify three main characters that need the explanation. The first one is the developers, because the developers aim to improve the performance of the models and generalize the models to unseen data. So using explainable AI algorithms, it's possible to remove inadequate features, of course. For the physician, because it's important to confirm or verify an existing clinical evidence, so it's important to search about the literature, the medical literature, and confirm the founded in the literature. And in the end, for the patients, that is the character that is affected by the decision of the system, to make the system GDPR compliant. So we can't use this system in the real clinical practice without without the explanation. This is the data used for this for our solution. The Hackathon Committee published this dataset composed by chest X-ray images and the clinical features. So we basically had the two different input, the images and the clinical features. To convert the images to tabular data and using this data to train machine learning algorithms, we convert the images to a salient representation using the radiomics. Radiomics basically is a field to convert the images in a salient representation, so convert images in basically in features. Radiomics workflow starts using starts with the identification of the region of interest. So in the first step, we identify the lung inside every images. We get the gray level of the lung of the region of interest to extract histogram features, the textural features, and we considered also Laplacian, Gaussian, and wavelet transform for the features extraction. So in the end, we extracted a lot of features, more than 1,000 known features, and merged with the clinical features. So in the end, we have radiomics features that are basically imaging features, and the clinical features. We merged both features and used the both for training the models. And so this is the main idea. The dataset was collected by six different hospitals. So we used all this dataset for the training of black box algorithms to predict the prognosis of COVID-19 patients between mild and severe. So it's a binary classification task. And the most important part is the post-hoc explanation. So we add this important step in order to explain our solution, in particular considering the physician, the developers, and the patient's point of view. So in general, we propose the multi-level explanation. So from technical point of view, we started with data cleaning. There was a lot of missing value to replace. We implement a strong feature selection strategy. We consider the near zero variance to remove features with no informative content, basically. We use the Spearman rank correlation coefficient to remove correlated features. The Mann-Whitney test to test the significant of every features. And in the end, we used the sequential feature selector to select the best features for each algorithm using. We trained using a stratified tenfold cross-validation strategy, repeated 20 times. And in the end, we provided the global and the local explanation. This is the results. Basically, the committee of the Hackathon committee published in the first step just the training dataset. So we used the training dataset to make a lot of experiments considering only clinical features, so only radiomic and the combination of clinical and radiomics features. The metrics considered for the competition was accuracy. Considering the little bit higher performance using clinical and radiomics features, we considered that our final models, the models that used both features. In the second step, the committee published the test data, which basically we computed the predicted label, so we inference for each test data, we make the prediction, and the committee computed the matching the true label with the predicted label, so the true prediction with the predicted. We computed the performance, and we got an accuracy about 69. that is considering the other words is a good performance. We analyze after the expression slide the comparison with other words. So after the accuracy, that is of course important, we focused on the explanation. In particular, we used the SHAP framework that uses the Shapley values that are values used in the game theory that basically are used to compute the contribution that every player plays in a match. So we can consider the match as the classification task and every player the features of the task to solve the task. So considering the Shapley value, we can compute the contribution that every features apport to the final prediction. This is the global explanation in which there is a kind of ranking of the most important features for COVID-19 prediction. This graph is really important because it was possible to find some important, to confirm some important medical founded. In particular, the LDH value, the LDH value that is the first one features, is the values that most affect the prediction about COVID-19. We can read this graph considering the red point, the high value for that feature, and the blue point as the low value for that feature. And to the right of the graph, we found the value that led the prediction through the severe prediction, and in the left part of the on the graph we have the value that led the prediction through mild prediction. So in this case, the high value of LDH means that the patient are in severe COVID-19 prognosis, and the low value of LDH mild prognosis, basically. There are also, for example, the age is of course intuitive because we have the age, older patients basically are most affected of severe COVID-19 prediction, and the younger patients are mild condition basically. And so this consideration is possible to make this consideration for each feature basically. We found a lot of papers that confirm this aspect about LDH, partial pressure, oxygen, age, glucose, and so on. So with this graph, we are sure that the founded of the models are right, and the models is a right models. For the local explanation, we able to obtain an explanation for each prediction. Basically, the previous graph shows the global explanation. So in general, the importance of every features for the task. With these two pictures, we can explain a specific patient, the prediction for a specific patient. The first picture is a mild prediction. The second one is the severe prediction. Inside there are the features that most affect this specific prediction. In the first case, there is a low value of the low LDH value, and radiomics features zone entropy that put the prediction through the mild prediction. In the second case, we have a higher LDH value and older age, basically, that put the prediction through the severe prediction. So in this case, we can able to justify the decision of the model to the patient, basically. Comparing our works with the other solution proposed by the hackathon. We got the our solution is the six considering the accuracy, but is between the first three considering the explainability of our of the solution. So it's important to emphasize an aspect that basically the first solution, the solution better than our solution in terms of accuracy, are all deep learning approach. So basically they use the different kind of convolutional neural network and the deep architectures. And basically in which the explanation is more complex. In fact, they are not averted about the explanation solution. Basically the explanation for deep architecture are the saliency map, but there are very recent papers. We put below just two references, but there are a lot of references that prove that this saliency map could be an optimistic explanation about the trained models. So it's possible that the saliency map are a good explanation, but in general the models doesn't work using the right features. So it's important to design a right trade-off between explainability and performance. We focused on the explainability. And for the reason we thinking about to improve this solution considering also deep architecture and compare with our bots. This solution was expanded and is under review process in the journal Expert System with Application. We consider and we detail a lot of aspects about the feature selection, explanation, multi-level explanation, and others aspects. So we have this paper under review in this journal. And to finish the presentation, we can discuss about some prospective future direction and opportunity. So I mentioned the comparison with deep features. We can consider a prospective multicentric study because the dataset was collected by six different Italian hospitals. So we have a multicentric database. So it's a could be a good opportunity to test in a prospective fashion this framework. This explainable framework, this explainable pipeline is possible to apply on different clinical applications. I talked about neuroimaging, in general neurodegenerative disease, breast cancer, and a lot of applications, but focusing on the explainable of solution. Basically, our laboratory is inside a hospital, a Palermitan hospital. So, to test this system in the real clinical practice, we need to talk about explainable artificial intelligence. So, to integrate this system in the real clinical practice, we are really focused on the explainable pipeline. And in the end, of course, Alex is not know that we are thinking about the Horizon program. In particular, we are focusing at this moment considering a program about transportly artificial intelligence. So we are focused on this in general on this topic. Thank you for the presentation and the opportunity. I'm here for every eventual questions. Thank you.
Maybe the last point we discussed it in another context, not now. I'm aware of it, but it's not the context. So I have some questions, maybe the others too, but maybe if it's okay, I will start. So one is the you say that the data are from different places. Mm-hmm. So there was some kind of harmonization, or and the other question maybe there was this provocative title, False Hope.
Yeah.
Why is false hope?
False hope. Basically, this the first questions is there is a simple answer. Basically, we are thinking to harmonize. We not consider the harmonization for the COVID-19 for the hackathon. Sorry, because basically the hackathon was organized that we had just 3 weeks to implement all this solution and present this solution. So some aspects are expanded in the journal article that is under review. Not harmonization, but is an aspect that we thinking to consider, of course. In particular, we found several framework to harmonize the data. We found, for example, I don't know if you know Combat framework.
Yes, unfortunately.
Perfect.
Yes.
Perfect. There is, for example, one of the future direction that we analyzing at this moment. Thank you for the question. The other, the false hope. Why false hope? Because there is a kind of exploiting of this saliency map to explain the deep learning architecture. It's proven that, for example, this saliency map works also if the models basically are not trained. So it's possible that the saliency map could view a good idea of the models that is right from a visual point of view, but in general the model is in a good training fashion. Okay, so the model could be in a wrong training process, so basically it doesn't work, but the saliency map are good. The saliency map have some sense, but the models doesn't work. Okay, so there are some example inside the reference in which is proved that this concept basically. And another thing, and maybe it's the last reference, in which basically there are a lot of criticism about this saliency map that basically is related to the human interpretation. So it said that our thinking is an optimistic thinking. So we can see some saliency map as a good explanation, but actually has no sense. Okay. So in another paper under review in another journal, computer science journal, we emphasize this aspect about the criticism through explainable artificial intelligence. There is a section that discusses about the criticism of explainable solution, and is of course an increment about these papers that analyze the really meaning about the explanation. So it's a really complex answer to organize. Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, I don't know.
Hi, Francesco, it's Arek. Very nice work.
Can you hear him?
Yeah, of course. Okay. Thank you.
I was wondering, you know, when you extract radiomics, you know, from those lung fields, yeah, are you doing this just once, or are you doing it separately for each lung?
When I extracted, the radiomics features?
Yeah.
What is the question?
Well, because you said that you extract the features from the lung fields, right?
Yeah.
Maybe the first one. So you take the left lung, you extract the radiomics feature, you take the right lung, you extract the radiomics feature, concatenate them and process them, right?
No. We considered the two lung for the features extraction. So we identify the two lung for every images, and we extract the features starting from the two lung, okay?
Yeah, because I don't know, my feel is that it's better to do it separately because, I mean, first of all, the shape features might be maybe important, and then the left lung may be affected, and then the effect of COVID could be higher and maybe better extracted. I don't know, just a thought.
Yeah, it's a good suggestion, but for example, we don't have the information about what lung is more has more lesions than the other lung. Okay, so we have a global information that is the COVID, the severe or mild prognosis. So we don't know the compromission of every lung. Okay,
you don't need it. You know, I just thought that this may be something that you can try. And my feel is that it will be better. Yeah, but I don't know.
So you suggest me to extract basically two kinds of features: the features for the first lung and the features for the second lung.
Yeah, and then concatenate them and then process them from there.
I don't think about. I think it's a good opportunity.
Yeah.
So because the inflammation or is it on one side.
It's like, you know, it's like when you take the one lung, you know, it's like one piece of information. So if you mix them with the other, and of course, radiomics features are global features.
It's right.
Yeah, and of course, you know, the explainability of radiomics, good luck explaining to physicians what is entropy. You know, it's going to be difficult.
No, actually, it is not true because it's possible. I mean,
it's patience.
With patience, it's possible patience. To explain it. Maybe for the first one, for the better two features, for the most important features, radiomics features, we tried to make an explanation that is basically expanded to the journal paper. But basically, we found the meaning. But of course, depend on the features to explain. There are features that are harder to explain than others, of course. But in general, we focus on radiomics features because it's hard work, but it's possible to explain. So we know what is these features. In the case of deep features, we really can't know what are the features because we have some. It is like a random number, basically. So we don't know the every value of features, deep features represent. It's impossible, basically.
Yeah, but there is not a problem with that because, you know, you do the removal of features that are correlated. So basically the features that you find that is in those shape values that is important is actually represent all the other features that were removed as well, right? So you should basically actually provide all the features that were correlated with the features that you provide in the over there because they are all correlated.
I don't understand the question. I'm sorry.
But no. So if in shape values you provide some features that are important that have influence, right?
Yeah.
And you give example of one radiomic features, right?
Okay.
But
for
when,
example,
in preparation you did the removal of the features that were correlated to the feature, right?
Do you want an explanation of?
No. I'm saying that the features that actually provide in the shape in this shape values.
Yeah.
This is just one feature, but they are and some number of features that you removed earlier. That basically have the same meaning, you know, as the one that you provide. So when you do the explanation. It's not only the features that you provide, but also all the other features that you remove because they are correlated.
Actually, we removed the correlated features in the feature selection step. So actually, we don't have the problem to have the correlated features in this scenario. When we computed this graph, basically, we have just already the model trained. So we didn't have, we have just the features that are good for, theoretically are good, okay? So are not related, are informative and statistical significant and so on.
Yeah, but let me put it this way. So you, if you select the group of features that are highly correlated, right?
Yeah.
And then you, at the beginning of the analysis, and then you use one features out of this group, right? So all the other features that left in that group, you know, you can replace one, you know what I'm saying? So, so when at the end, when you interpret, you know, the features that you just chose from that group is just an example. You know, all the other features that are correlated could be taken as well, and you give the same, you're gonna get the same results. So it's not only one features that you at the end say that it's important, but all the other features that were in the group that were highly
correlated. I'm so sorry, but I don't understand the questions. I'm really sorry. I don't I don't know.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
Maybe we follow up then another time. Other questions? You are all good? I don't know. If there are no other questions, we just send you a remote clap. And yeah, I will send you the video also because I was also not able to follow exactly the last comment.
I follow, yeah. So what Arik was saying is that when you remove at the beginning the features that are correlated and you only take one, in the end, you explain this one feature that you extracted. And you say, we cannot explain all the others. But what he's saying is like, since all of these features are correlated, if you explain one, you are indirectly explaining all the others. I think that's what he's saying.
We remove the correlated features in the first step, basically. So if we have the two features that are correlated, one is discarded and finishes, is stopped, this feature is eliminated, okay? So in the end, we have just one of the two features.
Yeah, but I think that he was making an assumption, which I'm not sure it's correct, but I don't know.
Okay. That
from the features that are correlated, you select one and you train the model. Yep. If you have selected another one, you would have obtained similar results.
Yeah.
And you would have explained another feature. So that means that the two features are equally explainable by only one of them. That's what I understood. It was his way, his reasoning, but I have no idea if this is correct.
That's right.
Okay.
So yeah, maybe
now I also got it.
Yeah. In fact, maybe your model is a lot more explainable than you thought. I don't know.
Okay, then we close it here. Actually, we have generally this talk on Friday before the weekend just to, you know, to prepare to relax. So we pretend we are drinking, but in the end it's just coffee.
I'm drinking some water before the talk, and so now I go to Mondello.
It's a kitchen palermo for those.
Alex, explain to the others what is Mondello.
It's a beach near Palermo. It's easy. Okay, then but for the rest we follow up via email or in other context.
Thank you another time for the opportunity, and if you are interested to detail something, to collaborate, to visit our laboratory, you can visit our laboratory, our website. There are contact of Professor Vitabile, that is the laboratory. So we are open for a lot of topics, basically. Thank you for the opportunity another time.
Okay. And bye.
Bye.
Bye.